Another quick motor update. So there were some questions about the motor and the capacitors and things like that. And I did a little brief explanation about how the capacitor adds a phase shift to the starting windings. And what I have set up here is my oscilloscope, and I have it hooked up to the motor, and I'm going to show on the oscilloscope what the phase shift is and how you can calculate exactly how many degrees of lead or lag that you have, and from that you can actually adjust your capacitor then to get it so it's perfect at 90 degrees if you want. And I already have the motor all hooked up with two channels, and one channel is the voltage on the incoming voltage, which would be the run winding when it's running, and the other is hooked up to the starting winding. So it will take a snapshot of the starting winding as it starts and show us that against the running of the motor or the run winding. All right, I'm going to plug it in and the motor's going to start. There we go. That's a little bit better zoomed in. Now, what we have here are the two sinusoidal waves of the motor. The one in the middle here, I have set, actually I have them set at both the 200 volts range, right? And the one in the middle here is the run winding as the motor is running here. The AA over here is marked by the A. This one was the start sinusoidal wave. And you can see how they're not in line with one another. How here there's the rising voltage, the peak, and on down, and then dropping down here. Now, my RAC here is 60 cycles. And then here, the peak of this one here, there's the peak, and on down to the peak. So that's one cycle, right? And it all matters, it's all a point of reference. If you use the running winding waveform as a reference, then the starting winding lagged it lags the run winding. And then some people will say it leads. Well, if you use this, then they'll say the running current is leading the starting current. So if you use the start winding as a reference, then yes, the other current leads. The thing is the difference in phase angle between the two waves. And we can move there's these dashed lines here. You'll see these, you should be able to see these dashed lines. So you'll see these dashed lines here, and those are cursor lines, and I'm going to adjust them a little bit here. Because what we want to do is we want to measure the difference in time. Now, like I said, this is 60 cycles. Both waves are 60 cycles, and the time difference between the cycles is what we need to check. Now, this meter will give us the right here. It's dt. It's the differential time between the two cursors, and I'm going to on both of the rising waveforms. Okay, so the rising waveform and the rising waveform, the time difference from 0 point to 0 point here. So we're going to adjust this cursor. I'm adjusting this cursor over at 0 voltage where it crosses the 0 voltage point, and then I'm going to adjust the other cursor, this one here, to cross at this waveform right there. That's comes up to be 5.2, 5.0 seconds, or milliseconds, between the two. Okay? Now we can do a quick little calculation to determine that phase shift angle between them. So we'll do a little math. So we know it's 60 cycles, and I don't have it set right here. I'll change here for frequency, and right here the frequency is 59.98, 60.01. It's 60 cycles for all intent purposes. So we'll go back here to the scope. So a 1 over 60 will give me how many milliseconds it is. Anyway, it's 16.6 milliseconds. Okay, so that's really it's 0.0166. Okay. Now, it's 300, one rotation of the generator that's generating this. It's 360 degrees from there to there for one cycle. Okay, so 360 degrees, 16.6 milliseconds, and that equals 21.68 degrees per millisecond. Well, our time difference between the two is 5 milliseconds. So 5 times 21.68 equals 108 degrees. So that's our phase shift angle is 108 degrees. Pretty simple. And by changing your capacitance, you can adjust that so that the current here, the voltage or the current here, is not lagging as much, or you might want to lag more. It all depends on what you want to do. Here we'd want to reduce it a little bit. So you can change your capacitance to adjust that. 108, that's right in the ballpark. It's good enough for us. I'm not going to change them. But anyway, this gives you a nice representation to see what's happening and stuff. I could change the scales here. You can see where more look the same. But by changing your scales too, what you could do is you can actually get a more accurate number if you want in there, and you know, move your cursors, and we could zoom in. Basically, we're zooming in. I can zoom in and might be able to get a little more accurate number. Yeah, 5.12. You know, it's going to change 5.2 milliseconds. So it makes it a 5.2 makes it a 112 degrees. Or you can even change our scales and get the waveform so they're steeper, where they cross, and then you're going to adjust your cursors maybe a little bit. Still, we're at 5.12 there, so it's close enough for what we're doing and demonstrating here. Anyway, that's why the motor starts, and how this type of system works. All right, I hope that helps everybody have an idea what's happening with their motor. This is a pretty good unit. I've had this really quite a long time, but it's an older unit. It's a Fluke 95 scope meter, but it works and works good. Battery's gone dead a long time ago, and I hit an auto set button here, and it kind of sets them both up, and you can see that phase shift between the two also there. Anyway, so I hope that helps everybody, and kind of a cool thing to see. And we'll catch you in the next one.